Organization of American Historians and in the Bedford Public Library, which has been having a series of author talks, and we'll make sure that you get the information on the next one that's coming out. So let me take a minute to introduce Professor Sinha to all of you. Manisha Sinha is the Draper Chair in American History at the University of Connecticut in Storrs. She was born in India and received her PhD from Columbia University, where her dissertation was nominated for the Bancroft Prize. She is author of The Counter-Revolution of Slavery, Politics and Ideology in Antebellum South Carolina, which was named one of the 10 best books on slavery in Politico in 2015. And she's also, of course, the author of The Slave's Cause, A History of Abolition, which is at Yale University Press. The Slave's Cause has been reviewed by the New York Review of Books, the Wall Street Journal, the New York Times, BBC History, the Christian Science Monitor, the Atlantic, the Nation, and the Boston Globe, among other newspapers and journals. It was longlisted for the National Book Award for Nonfiction, and those nominations are coming out again in like 2 weeks, I think. It was also featured as the editor's choice of the New York Times Book Review recently, and named the Book of the Week by Times Higher Education in May to coincide with its United Kingdom publication. Sinha is a contributing author of The Abolitionist Imagination. She is a co-editor of the two-volume African American Mosaic, a documentary history from the African slave trade to the 21st century, and Contested Democracy, Freedom, Race, and Power in American History. She was awarded the Chancellor's Medal, the highest medal bestowed on faculty, and received the Distinguished Graduate Mentor Award in recognition of outstanding graduate teaching and advising at the University of Massachusetts Amherst, where she taught for over 20 years. And UMass just lost her. She is the elected member of the American Antiquarian Society and was appointed to the Organization of American Historians Distinguished Lecture Series, which is how we contacted her. She is a recipient of numerous fellowships, including 2-year-long research fellowships from the National Endowment for the Humanities, fellowships from the Charles Warren Center and the W.E.B. Du Bois Institute at Harvard University, the Howard University Foundation Fellowship, the Rockefeller Postdoctoral Fellowship from the Institute of the Arts and Humanities at the University of North Carolina, Chapel Hill, and the Whiting Fellowship for Columbia University. She is a member of the Council of Advisors for the Lapidus Center for the Historical Analysis of Transatlantic Slavery at the Schomburg, co-editor of Race in the Atlantic World, 1700 to 1900, and is on the editorial board of the Journal of the Civil War Era. So I would like to now introduce you and have Dr. Sinha do the presentation. Thank you.
Thank you, Lee. But today I will talk about one of the themes, which is slave resistance. And so Lee is going to be my partner in clicking the slideshow, and we'll begin with the first slide, which is really just the cover of the book. So, you know, while a black celebration of the abolition movement with its radical edges shorn off inhabits popular culture, the dominant picture of abolitionists in American history is that of romantic religious reformers burdened by racial paternalism and economic conservatism. So instead, I argue in this book, The Slave's Cause, that slave resistance lay at the heart of the abolition movement from the American Revolution to the Civil War. It was constitutive of abolition rather than distinct from it. To read the enslaved out of the abolition movement is to profoundly miss the part they played in defining its protest traditions. The actions and ideas of slave rebels and runaways did not lie outside of abolition, but shaped its goals. Some historians of slavery have declared black resistance to slavery passé, but it lay at the heart of the abolition movement. The connection between slave resistance and abolition in the United States was proximate and continuous. Servants and slave rebellions paralleled and inspired pioneering anti-slavery protests by Quakers and other Protestant dissenters in British North America. For the enslaved, slavery was a state of war, as it was for the early Quaker abolitionists, who argued that it violated their peace testimony. Abolitionists, starting with the 1688 Germantown protests, regularly alluded to slave resistance as evidence of the injustice of slavery. According to John Hepburn, quote, "We disgrace ourselves when we condemn and punish our Negroes for seeking by running away to get their freedom." Ralph Sandford, another Quaker abolitionist, excoriated slaveholders who, quote, "who whipped naked to common view and racked and burnt to death recalcitrant slaves." Now in 1737, the hunchback vegetarian Quaker dwarf Benjamin Lay, pictured here on your right, published his 271-page philippic, "All slave keepers that keep the innocent in bondage are bastards." Quoting the scriptures as if to justify slave rebellion, he wrote, quote, "It's better to die by the sword than by the famine." As a God-fearing Quaker, Lay stated that he would say no more, but quote, "the Tories lies that slaves are content will never go down well." I was talking about Lay and some of these early Quaker abolitionists who pointed to instances of slave resistance to argue that that's how they came to the abolition movement. So besides Lay, the preeminent Quaker abolitionist John Woolman on the left and Anthony Benezet, pictured in a school that he opened for black children, attributed their anti-slavery beliefs to the devastation wrought by the slave trade in West Africa and to their first-hand accounts of witnessing the horrors of slave trade and slavery. Most early Quaker abolitionists, many of them former indentured servants, and men and women of humble origins empathized with the plight of the enslaved. Anti-slavery sentiment among a handful of American colonists, predominantly Quakers, grew in tandem with black resistance to slavery. Puritan Judge Samuel Sewall, pictured here, he of course was involved with the Salem witchcraft trials. He later regretted his role in those and was actually on the right side of the question as far as slavery was concerned. So Sewall was inspired to write his anti-slavery pamphlet, The Selling of Joseph, in 1700, on reading an African couple's petition for freedom. He assisted the enslaved Adam's successful freedom suit against the merchant John Savin, who had written a pro-slavery rejoinder to his pamphlet. Adam's actions were indicative of the various anti-slavery strategies employed by enslaved African Americans. With the help of sympathetic whites like Sewall, enslaved Africans brought freedom suits against their masters on various grounds: Christianization, verbal or written agreements granting freedom, self-purchase, ill usage and brutality, or evidence of white or Native American ancestry. We need to broaden our conception of slave resistance. The enslaved's, quote, freedom claims included appropriating and critiquing law and religion as instruments of liberation. Now, of course, the precedent of freedom suits goes right down to the Dred Scott decision in 1857. But the law by itself would seldom act as an engine of emancipation. Indeed, at the very moment that English common law was being systematized, the enslaved laid claim to its notions of personal liberty and security. In Britain, runaway slaves, building on colonial precedents of freedom suits, led Granville Sharp to apply English notions of law and liberty to Africans. By 1765, William Blackstone affirmed in his influential commentaries on the laws of England that English law did not recognize slavery, but clarified in later editions of his work that a master's, quote, right to service continued. Most consequentially, James Somerset, who had run away from his master, Charles Stuart, formerly of Virginia, recruited Sharp in his quest for freedom. Stewart had resided in Boston, and the rise in the number of freedom suits in late 18th century Massachusetts may well have influenced Somerset. In Somerset versus Stewart, the Lord Chief Justice William Murray, Earl of Mansfield, denied colonial slaveholders the right to forcibly transport their slaves out of England. The decision represented a happy marriage between slave resistance and abolitionist notions of English common law. Somerset damaged slaveholders' prerogatives and rendered the enslavement of Africans insecure in Britain. Now, a runaway slave instigated a historic anti-slavery ruling, and it is only fitting that his name graces this landmark Anglo-American decision. African Americans, anti-slavery lawyers, and abolitionists would use the legal precedent of freedom claims in the Somerset decision right down to the Civil War in the northern states. Now, black people throughout the British Atlantic breathed life into the Somerset decision or the freedom principle, celebrating it as the end of slavery in England and using it to abscond from their masters. Growing numbers of freedom suits, particularly the cases of Quok Walker or Mumbet or Elizabeth Freeman, led to the judicial abolition of slavery in Massachusetts in 1783. And this, of course, is a portrait of Mumbet. Now, my students are always amazed when I tell them that Massachusetts abolished slavery not because of some sort of law that was passed down from up above, but because of the actions of two ordinary slaves who sued their masters for their freedom. It was not just Latter-day abolitionists who construed the Somerset decision and the Walker and Freeman cases as having led to the destruction of slavery. The enslaved themselves appropriated and expanded notions of legal freedom and rights. Enslaved freedom petitioners in New England not only demanded an end to slavery and compensation, but popularized the works of unknown abolitionists such as James Swan and John Allen. In 1774, Allen, in his An Oration on the Beauties of Liberty, or the Essential Rights of Americans, not only lifted the works of black freedom petitioners, but also reprinted their 1773 petition that was written by a group of men, Peter Bestus, Samuel Freeman, Felix Holbrook, and Chester Joye, and they formed themselves, quote, into an anti-slavery committee. And I contend that this is actually the first instance of an anti-slavery organization being formed, even though it did not last that long. This committee and another group, the Sons of Africa, modeled most likely after the Sons of Liberty, predated the formation of the first abolition society in Philadelphia. The Sons of Africa were the organizational moniker that Afro-British abolitionists and former slaves such as Olaudah Equiano, pictured here, the next slide, and Atoba Pagano adopted for their anti-slave trade petitions in Britain in the 1780s and 1790s. Now, Equiano, of course, was the author of one of the first slave narratives ever published, and was very active in the British movement to abolish the African slave trade. The Anglo-American abolition movement got its permanent organizational expression with the formation of the Society for the Relief of Free Negroes Unlawfully Held in Bondage on April 15, 1775, at the initiative of 10 Quaker abolitionists in Philadelphia. Most of them were associates of its leading organizer, the English-born tailor, Thomas Harrison. Again, men of humble pursuits. A lot of these early Quaker abolitionists were not merchants, not the leading men of their societies. They were tailors, indentured servants, men of humble means. Now, this society meant to help a woman of mixed Indian and African heritage from New Jersey interned in a workhouse, Dinah Neville. You will see that this is a fanciful 19th century representation of that founding moment. She was about to be sold into slavery with her four children, even though she claimed to be free. The very title of the society suggests how black efforts to gain freedom spurred abolitionist organization. The society met only four times that year, but brought to court six cases of wrongful enslavement. The American Revolution facilitated not just slavery, slave rebelliousness, but also massive action. Most use wartime disruption to simply flee. Entire families and communities, women, children, and the elderly, voted with their feet against slavery. A recent estimate has scaled down the numbers of runaways originally proposed by Jefferson considerably, showing that at most 20,000 slaves ran away to the British, 12,000 alone from the southern states. Even so, historian Gary Nash has called this the largest unknown slave rebellion in American history. A rash of slave revolts and conspiracies, beginning with Tacky's revolt in Jamaica, spread through the Caribbean and the southern colonies in the 1760s and 1770s. At the end of the revolution, thousands of black loyalists who had taken up arms responding to British offers of freedom abandoned the slaveholding republic, journeying to the Caribbean, Canada, England, Australia, and West Africa in their quest for freedom. Some were literally, quote, fleeing the founding fathers, runaway slaves of Washington, Jefferson, Madison, and Patrick Henry. More than the American Revolution and its aftermath, which resulted in the gradual abolition of slavery in the northern states, most northern states passed these gradual emancipation laws, starting with Pennsylvania in 1780, right down to New Jersey in 1804. So more than the American Revolution that created this nation that was sort of half slave and half free, because the South, of course, proved resistant to abolition, the Haitian Revolution from 1791 to 1804 was an abolition revolution, the Haitian Revolution that is normally not seen as part of the abolition movement, but it was. In Saint-Domingue, slave rebellion was the face of revolutionary republicanism. While some scholars still debate the contradictory effects of the Haitian Revolution, thanks to it, revolutionary resistance to slavery became a part of the abolitionist lexicon. The best exponents of revolutionary abolition were the slaves themselves, whose world historical actions forever changed the dynamic in the battle between slavery and freedom. The Haitian Revolution would inspire black resistance throughout the Americas, most notably the 1812 Aponte Rebellion in Cuba, the 1811 German Coast Rebellion in Louisiana, and put abolition on the agenda of the Latin American Wars of Independence. So it has an important abolitionist legacy for the entire Western Hemisphere. This bloody and decisive challenge to slavery and white supremacy, notwithstanding Haiti's subsequent political instability and poverty, aggravated by the colonial policies of its erstwhile rulers and enemies, became sanctified in abolitionist memory. While much has been written about the pro-slavery response to the Haitian Revolution and the efforts of European slave-holding nations and the United States to form a cordon sanitaire around the Black Republic, abolitionist reaction to it is understudied. The commonly accepted notion that abolitionists distanced themselves from the Haitian revolutionaries defies the historical record. This is true not just of the French abolitionists and the Société des Noirs, which supported the fight for citizenship rights for free people of color and later abolition, but also the British movement to abolish the slave trade. And you will see these British abolitionists who defended Haiti. Thomas Clarkson, pictured here on the left, wrote one of the earliest defenses of slave rebellion in Saint-Domingue in 1792, and Haiti named one of its man of war's Wilberforce after the British abolitionist parliamentarian, pictured here on the right. So the Haitians themselves saw themselves as a part of a broader abolition movement. In the United States, Abraham Bishop asked anti-slavery societies to assist the slave rebels, quote, with pen, the tongue, the counsel, the sword, and money. In his 1802 pamphlet, Negro Slavery Unjustified, Reverend Alexander McLeod, another American abolitionist, argued, quote, great must be his prejudice who can deny to the black Toussaint the qualifications of a warrior and a statesman. More concretely, the Pennsylvania Abolition Society and the Standing Committee of the New York Manumission Society helped free Haitian slaves brought by fleeing masters by bringing them under the purview of their state emancipation laws. Most northern states had these abolition societies, and of course, the New York Manumission Society counted amongst its members Alexander Hamilton, who has gained newfound popularity thanks to Broadway. So, free black Haitian immigrants also, like John Apple and Joseph Cassie, joined the abolition movement, with the latter becoming one of the most successful agents of William Lloyd Garrison's The Liberator. Slave rebellion spawned radical abolitionism in the Anglo-American world. We'll see that in Britain, the Quaker abolitionist Elizabeth Heron, unknown to most historians, coupled her call for immediate abolition. This is the first known instance for a call for immediate, not gradual abolition. Immediate, uncompensated abolition. Uncompensated to slaveholders, that is. She coupled her call for immediate abolition with a passionate defense of the Demerara slave rebellion of 1823. The rebels evoked the name of Wilberforce and powerful metropolitan allies against their colonial masters, but their acts of resistance also steered abolitionists towards immediatism, or the immediate, unconditional, uncompensated end to slavery. In the United States, David Walker, arguably author of the first abolitionist pamphlet of the Second Wave, Appeal to the Colored Citizens of the World, was probably in Charleston during the Denmark-Vesey slave conspiracy scare of 1822. The growth of militant black abolitionism in the 1820s, epitomized actually by Walker's pamphlet, was closely tied to not just a rejection of the repatriation scheme of the American Colonization Society, which basically proposed to colonize all free blacks back to Africa. It was a scheme that Jefferson supported, along with American statesmen, presidents, etc. But militant black abolitionism was tied to the rejection of the scheme of colonization, but also to slave resistance. Walker, for instance, called Haiti, quote, the glory of the blacks and the terror of tyrants. In the first year of its publication, the black abolitionist newspaper, Freedom's Journal, devoted many pages to the history of Haiti and a glowing biography of Toussaint Louverture. And of course, Freedom's Journal preceded The Liberator. It was published from 1827 to 1829. The decade that incubated black abolitionism ended with dramatic instances of slave rebellion. In 1831, two major slave revolts shook the foundations of Anglo-American slavery. Coming at the heels of the publication of Garrison's Liberator, Nat Turner's No Quarters Given Rebellion became irrevocably linked to the birth of radical abolitionism. And here is a contemporary representation, of course, of Turner being discovered in the woods after his rebellion. And now, of course, there is a controversial movie about this rebellion, The Birth of Nation. Now, while slave rebellion prompted debates over emancipation in Virginia, now it's important to note that, you know, that Nat Turner's rebellion prompted debates over emancipation in the Virginia General Assembly, a state that had kind of given up on abolition. Most southern states were not talking about emancipation at this time. Now, of course, the people advocating emancipation eventually failed in Virginia. The fact remains that Turner's rebellion had led to that debate. While it failed in Virginia, rebellion actually precipitated British abolition. The charismatic Samuel Daly Sharp, pictured there on the left, led the so-called Baptist War, or Christmas Rebellion, in Jamaica, involving nearly 60,000 slaves. Abolitionist Minister Henry Levy noted that the revolt and its brutal suppression dealt, quote, a death wound to colonial slavery and accelerated its destruction. 1 week after Sharp's execution in 1832, Parliament appointed a select committee to explore the expediency of, quote, effecting the extinction of slavery throughout the British dominions. And of course, Britain abolished slavery in its colonies in 1833. Now, it is true that there were other factors that were involved. The Great Reform Act of 1832 that liberalized voting to the British Parliament, the abolitionist petition campaigns, but really rebellion was the catalyst that led to British abolition. Now, while denied charges of inciting rebellions, the pacifist Garrison clearly aligned himself with slave resistance. One of Garrison, not uncommonly seen, but it is my favorite portrait of Garrison because it was done by a black artist, a black abolitionist artist, Robert Douglas Jr. in Philadelphia. Remarking on the suppression of Turner's rebellion, Garrison wrote, quote, "a dastardly triumph, well becoming a nation of oppressors," unquote. So contrary to conventional wisdom, Garrison refused to repudiate slave rebellion, even though, like most of the early Quakers I talked about, he was a pacifist in principle. He even published an imaginary dialogue between Washington and Toussaint, the former's disadvantage, and a sympathetic history of Haiti, which he claimed, quote, "has been so misunderstood and misrepresented, affords unanswerable evidence for immediatism." Garrison never stopped praising slave rebellions, even after adopting non-resistance, a radical form of pacifism that rejected the use of all force, even by the state. His praise of John Brown and support for the war against slavery was no sudden turnabout, but a long-standing position that consistently valued abolition above his peace principles. Writing hagiographic biographies of slave rebels, including Lowenshire, Turner, and later Brown, became a mini-industry among abolitionists. You can see many of these abolitionists who were Garrisonian pacifists writing about slave rebellions and defending them. You had black and white abolitionists do that. Lydia Maria Child on the left, who of course wrote the famous pamphlet, An Appeal on Behalf of That Class of Americans Whom We Call Africans. It was a pamphlet against racism. There Wendell Phillips, who was a close compatriot, of course, of Garrison. Black abolitionists like James McKean Smith in the middle, William Wells Brown on top, whose daughters apparently stayed with the Johnsons, right, in New Bedford. And below, of course, Thomas Wentworth Higginson, who wrote a number of essays on slave rebels on the eve of the Civil War and led a black Union Army regiment during the war. So the political significance of slave resistance in the sectional conflict over slavery is also understudied. It gave abolition its most enduring issue, the fugitive slave controversy, and provided the movement with its most dynamic exponents, fugitive slave abolitionists. This is a picture of a runaway slave that adorned American newspapers right from the colonial era, right down to the Civil War. It was a constant issue, the numbers of slaves who simply ran away to freedom. The argument that most Americans saw slaves as complicit in their enslavement flies in the face of the history of slave resistance and its impact on national politics, international law, diplomacy, and popular sentiment. Slave resistance revolutionized abolitionist discourse and practice, moving abolition into northern state and courthouses. Enslaved, quote, freedom seekers contributed to the breakdown of comity between southern and northern states. Not only did slaves run away frequently, they displayed considerable political acumen in discerning the social geography of slavery and freedom. Conservative estimates of 1,000 runaways per year based on the US Census records of 1850 to 1860, an official count of essentially an illegal activity, and the first completed under a pro-slavery ideologue, J.D.B. DeVoe of New Orleans, was an obvious undercount. Today, historians count the number of fugitive slaves between 1830 and 1860 at 150,000, higher than Albert Bushnell Hart's original estimate of 60,000. According to a recent study, around 50,000 slaves ran away each year, many remaining in the South and some absconding temporarily. So many sort of ran away, were caught, not many of them made it all the way to the North. So if you just look at the activity in terms of running away, we have a much larger picture of slave resistance. Maribyrnong, within the slave South as in the dismal swamp was also more common than previously thought. These were communities of runaway slaves, maroon communities of runaway slaves who formed these communities in inaccessible areas like the dismal swamp between Virginia and North Carolina. Now we lack figures for those who made good their escape to Mexico or by sea to the Caribbean or to Indian territory, and some in fact stowed away all the way to England. We may never know the exact number of fugitive slaves, many of whom were recaptured. So ubiquitous were runaways that Dr. Samuel Cartwright of Louisiana diagnosed slaves' tendency to run away as a disease. He called it trypanosomiasis. He couldn't understand why these slaves were running away. He thought it was a physical disease rather than their dissatisfaction with their situation. So fugitive slaves shaped abolitionist tactics and discourse. The first black abolitionist petitions and letters, authored by Absalom Jones, pictured here on the right, Richard Allen on the left, and James Horton in the middle, concerned the fugitive slave and slave law and kidnapping of free blacks. Now, some of you would be interested in knowing that Allen and Jones were the founders of the African Methodist Episcopal Church, the church that was attacked in Charleston last summer. So it was a very historic black church, founded in fact by black abolitionists. Outstanding individual abolitionists, such as Quakers Isaac D. Harper, pictured there on the left, Levi Coffin, known as the president of the Underground Railroad, Thomas Garrett, pictured here at the bottom, he's the one who actually helped Harriet Tubman escape, and Presbyterian minister John Rankin on the top right, he was in Ohio, made assistance to fugitive slaves a quintessential form of abolitionist activism. And their careers really spanned the first wave of abolition in the Revolutionary era to the more sort of radical Garrisonian pre-Civil War phases. They were active all through. Quaker women too, like Laura Hadland, pictured here at the bottom, was also was important in the Underground Railroad. She was known towards the end of her abolitionist career to actually venture down south and help slaves escape, like Tubman. The history of the Underground Railroad must rise above the story of heroic individuals, or dismissed as the stuff of myth and memory. It must be placed in its proper historical context, the growth of slave resistance and American abolitionism. In the first two decades of the 19th century, Quaker abolitionists like Benjamin Lundy, you will see Lundy, he was a mentor, in fact, to Garrison, and African Americans in Ohio, Philadelphia, Baltimore, and Boston had formed, quote, humane and protection societies against kidnapping. So the movie that you are probably now aware of, the 12 Years of Slave movie, kidnapping of northern free blacks happened as often as, and there were many cases around the kidnapping of free blacks as there were cases of fugitive slaves coming into the north. Black abolitionists established the organizational apparatus of what came to be known as the Underground Railroad. This was the vigilance committees of the 1830s. David Ruggles, who is pictured there in the top left with Isaac Hopper and Barney Coase of the New York Manumission Society, helped found and became the secretary of the New York Committee of Vigilance in 1835, and he was most responsible for this tactical innovation, the creation of these vigilance committees. Ruggles built on the strategies developed by Hopper and Barney Coase, but the committee was his brainchild, and he ran it virtually single-handedly. Calling themselves, quote, the Friends of Human Rights, the Committee of Vigilance assisted fugitive slaves and rescued kidnapped Southern and local free blacks. They enslaved in ships involved in the illegal international slave trade, because the African slave trade had been abolished by Britain and the United States in 1808, and slaves in transit with their masters. Often denied legal rights by their enslavers and law enforcement officers in cahoots with them, the committee hired anti-slavery lawyers to represent African Americans caught between slavery and freedom, and successfully petitioned the New York state government for the right to trial by jury for suspected fugitives. Black vigilance committees inspired by Ruggles arose all over the North. The 1837 case of Basil Dorsey, who had escaped slavery with his brothers a year earlier, 1836, led black abolitionists like Robert Purvis, who is there pictured in the middle at the top, a founding member of the American Anti-Slavery Society, to establish the Philadelphia Vigilant Committee. Its most active member was a black barber, Jacob C. White, who kept a meticulous minute book of the Vigilant Committee of Philadelphia from 1839 to 1844, which still survives and had escaped the attention of most historians. The Philadelphia Female Anti-Slavery Society funded the Vigilant Committee's activities as well as a Black Female Vigilant Association. So women abolitionists were also involved in this relatively dangerous work. In the 1850s, it became the famous Philadelphia Committee of Vigilance, whose most active member, William Still, pictured here at the bottom right, documented its history. Detroit's Colored Vigilant Committee, founded by William Lambert, a Quaker-educated black abolitionist from New Jersey, and George B. Baptiste, a free black man from Virginia, also fought for the desegregation of the public school system and operated as a secret fraternal order and as an immigration society. So these vigilant committees were really abolitionist organizations who took on a lot of other causes besides helping fugitive slaves. Black vigilance committees spread to Canada among fugitive slave communities. Black abolitionists such as Reverend Jermaine Lagoon in Syracuse, he's there at the top right, he's famous for saying the fugitive slave law outlaws me and therefore I outlaw it. Stephen and Harriet Myers in Albany, you can see Stephen Myers at the bottom on the left. Thomas and Francis Brown in Pittsburgh, Lewis and Harriet Hayden in Boston, he's pictured there at the bottom, founded local vigilance committees and led the shock troops involved in the famous fugitive slave rescues of the 1850s. Many of them, like Lagoon and Hayden, were fugitive slaves themselves. Now, I tried my best to get a picture of Nathan Johnson in New Bedford, because Nathan and Mary, or Polly Johnson, like these other black abolitionists and their wives, were just as important in the Underground Railroad. There's a reason why New Bedford was called the Fugitives to Gibraltar, as its historian has written. But unfortunately, I couldn't find a picture of Nathan Johnson. It would be great if we had one. But clearly, what they were doing in New Bedford were what black abolitionists were doing all over the North. They didn't form a vigilance committee, probably because they lived in a town known for its anti-slavery sympathies, but clearly they were involved in this kind of active abolitionism that other black abolitionists all over the North were involved in. We can see that grassroots activism complemented and worked in tandem with legal and political strategies deployed by abolitionist lawyers and anti-slavery politicians. In the 1836 case, Commonwealth versus Aves, Judge Lemuel Shaw denied slaveholders the right to transit with their slaves in Massachusetts. Abolitionist Ellis Gray Loring, pictured there on the left, with his co-counsel Rufus Choate, called for applying the Somerset principle to Massachusetts, especially since the case involved not just the right to transit, but residence in a free state. The Aves case was brought by the Boston Female Anti-Slavery Society, again, showing the activism of women, and it involved a six-year-old slave girl by the name of Med. Other northern states after Aves moved to deny slaveholders the, quote, right to transit with their slaves. In 1837, a legislative report by abolitionist James Alvord questioned the constitutionality of the 1793 Fugitive Slave Act, and Massachusetts restored the right of trial by jury for fugitives. In New York, abolitionist lawyer and founder of the Abolitionist Liberty Party, Albert Stewart, pictured there in the top middle, arguing for two black boys apprehended as fugitive slaves, used the writ of habeas corpus to hinder recapture. And this is what anti-slavery lawyers did. They used all the legal tactics available to them to prevent the recapture of fugitive slaves. In 1839, Governor William Henry Seward of New York, pictured near the bottom right. Of course, he was a neighbor of Tubman's and lent her the money to buy her house. Refused to extradite three free black seamen involved in a fugitive slave rescue to the state of Virginia. And of course, Seward went on to become Lincoln's Secretary of State. Now, the state of Maine turned down, I don't think they will do it today, but they did then. Maine turned down an extradition request from Georgia for two men accused of assisting runaway slaves. The Maine Anti-Slavery Society asked rhetorically if Georgians planned to invade the state and, quote, carry off the men by force. A year later, New York also repealed the 9-month transit provision for slaveholders. The 1837 case of Matilda Lawrence, who fled to freedom in Cincinnati with the help of a black barber and was employed by the abolitionist James Birney, became a testing case for the freedom principle in the state of Ohio. The state Supreme Court dropped the indictment against Birney for knowingly violating the state's law against harboring a fugitive. Matilda's and Birney's lawyer was the young Solomon Chase, pictured there on the top right, who would, of course, be one of the founders of the Abolitionist Liberty Party and, of course, became Lincoln's Secretary of Treasury. Though Matilda lost her dearly won freedom, Chase launched his career as, quote, the Attorney General for Fugitive Slaves. He fought many such cases whose decisions effectively nullified slaveholders' right to transit with their slaves in Ohio. So abolitionist challenges to the Fugitive Slave Clause of the U.S. Constitution and federal law finally reached the Supreme Court in the Craig versus Pennsylvania case in 1842. Slave catcher Edward Craig had captured Margaret, who married a free man, and her three children, who had been born in freedom, born and brought up in freedom, and carried them back to Maryland without legal proceedings, as required by Pennsylvania's personal liberty law of 1826. Prigg and his associates were convicted of kidnapping by a Pennsylvania grand jury, and the conviction was upheld by the state courts. Prigg appealed his case all the way to the Supreme Court. Chief Justice Joseph Story's majority decision upheld the constitutionality of the Fugitive Slave Act of 1793 and declared all northern state laws that contravened it unconstitutional. While Story's pro-slavery decision in one fell swoop got rid of all the legal protections painstakingly won by the enslaved and their abolitionist allies, it also made recapture a federal responsibility, leaving a loophole for northern non-cooperation. His decision not only outlawed northern personal liberty laws, but also Ohio's notorious fugitive slave law, was a state law, which was then promptly repealed in 1843. Now, there were many lawyers who actually continued to assist fugitive slaves, and some of them were black. Robert Morris of Boston here, pictured, who studied law under Ellis Gray Laurie, became actually the first black lawyer to practice before the United States Supreme Court during the Civil War. But before the war, he actually was involved in Boston's public school desegregation case and also in fugitive slave law cases. The first fallout from Prigg occurred when suspected fugitive George Latimer, he was apprehended in Boston in October 1842 by a Virginian slaveholder from Norfolk and lodged in a jail to prevent, quote, a hostile crowd of blacks from rescuing him. Abolitionists launched a massive protest campaign. A Latimer committee formed by Dr. Henry I. Bowditch, William F. Channing, among others, started publishing the first fugitive slave abolitionist newspaper, the Latimer Journal and North Star, to give voice to, quote, the moral feeling and strength of the community. And you can see that Frederick Douglass got the name of his first newspaper, the North Star, from this particular newspaper. A group of black men, probably the New England Freedom Association, formed by black abolitionists William Cooper Nell and Charles Remond, stood ready to spirit Latimer away from prison. Abolitionist mobilization and popular pressure achieved what legal writs failed to do. Latimer was released to the custody of his claimant, who agreed to sell him. Black Bostonians raised the money to buy his freedom. Unprecedented cooperation between Garrisonians and Liberty Party men in the Latimer case revealed how the fugitive slave issue united different factions of the movement. Because by this time, the abolition movement was divided between Garrisonians who believed in non-political agitation and Liberty Party political abolitionists who believed more in using political ways to achieve abolition. And then, of course, there were the evangelical abolitionists who also did not like Garrison's radicalism, his support for women's rights, and his criticism of the church. So the movement was divided into these different groups, but when it came to a fugitive slave issue, like the Latimer case, they would all come together and cooperate. The Latimer or Great Massachusetts petition, with over 64,000 signatures, demanding a law forbidding the use of state officials and jails in fugitive slave rendition and, quote, separating the people of Massachusetts from slavery, was sent to the general court. Another with around 51,000 signatures to Congress was sent to John Quincy Adams, who of course was known for defending abolitionist petitions in Congress, and they asked for the repeal of the federal fugitive slave law. Massachusetts Latimer law, as it was called, forbade the use of state facilities in fugitive slave rendition. In 1847, Pennsylvania followed suit at the height of the controversy over the expansion of slavery during the Mexican War and passed a new personal liberty law. So despite Craig, you had actually northern states trying again to get around the fugitive slave law. Not just the political and legal controversies provoked by fugitive slaves, two famous shipboard rebellions, one by enslaved Africans and the other by American slaves, the Amistad in 1839 and the Creole in 1841, helped spell out the significance of slave resistance in national politics and international law and diplomacy. You may have heard of this rebellion or seen the movie based on it that came out a few years ago. Not a bad movie, but at times historically inaccurate. In June 1839, Sinkwe Pay and his comrades, part of a cargo of 53 Africans, including four children, being transported on the schooner La Amistad from Havana, Cuba, to the plantations in Puerto Príncipe, rose in revolt. This is a rendition of Sinkwe that was actually done by Nathaniel Jocelyn, who was the brother of an abolitionist, Simeon Jocelyn, and it was commissioned by the black abolitionist Robert Purvis. So, apprehended by Lieutenant Gedney on board a U.S. Navy ship, the Amistad was towed to New London, Connecticut. Sinkwe and 38 adult men were indicted for murder and piracy. Local abolitionist Dwight James, who argued that the Africans, quote, had a perfect right to get their liberty by killing the crew and taking possession of the vessel, immediately alerted New York abolitionists Lewis Tappan and Joshua Levitt, who organized the Amistad Committee to, quote, receive donations, employ counsel, and for the protection and relief of the African captives. The Amistad case also united abolitionists across factional lines, with the appeals of the committee appearing regularly in Garrisonian newspapers. The committee was actually formed mainly by these evangelical abolitionists like Tappan. Now, the Amistad Committee became a model for abolitionist committees formed to free imprisoned abolitionists accused of assisting fugitive slaves. We can see some of them. Charles Story on your extreme left on the top, who died in a Maryland jail. Calvin Fairbank in the middle, who was actually imprisoned in a jail in Kentucky right until the Civil War. He was freed only during the Civil War. And of course, Daniel Drayton, who was involved in the famous massive fugitive slave case, the rescue involving many slaves on the ship Pearl in 1848, many of them slaves of Southern congressmen, actually. Drayton was imprisoned for a very, very long time because of his involvement in this massive escape attempt in Washington, D.C. And he eventually came to New Bedford and died. He actually committed suicide because he was completely broken in mental and physical health by the time he was released from prison. And his grave is right here in New Bedford, and hopefully I'll have a chance to visit it after this talk. And then there was George Thompson on the bottom left, who was imprisoned in Missouri and ended up with the Amistad mission in Africa. And then of course Jonathan Walker, who was involved in a fugitive slave rescue in Florida. He was imprisoned and his hand was branded SS for slave stealer. So, you know, these abolitionists were not just talking the talk, they were actually doing fairly dangerous work by trying to, quote, run off slaves. So now, the Amistad case was tried in the U.S. Supreme Court in 1841 on appeal. Taft retained the services of John Quincy Adams as senior counsel. And Chief Justice Story accepted abolitionist reasoning. He argued that the Africans had been, quote, kidnapped and had a natural right to, quote, self-defense. He, however, remanded the Spanish slave Antonio back to slavery, making a distinction between the illegal African slave trade and legal slavery. Now, abolitionists made no such distinction, and Antonio, with the help of Tappan and the local Committee of Vigilance, fled to Montreal through the abolitionist underground. Now, at the very time that the Amistad Africans were heading home, another ship board a rebellion, this time in the American Great Creole with 135 slaves, was led by the fortuitously named Virginian slave, Madison Washington. Now, Washington, who had successfully escaped to Canada and was familiar with the abolitionists underground, returned. So he had fled successfully, but he went back to Virginia to free his enslaved wife. He was captured and sold in the waterborne domestic slave trade. And you know the domestic slave trade, if there was a movement of fugitive slaves going north, the domestic slave trade was a huge business in the antebellum South. Over a million slaves were sold in it from the upper South to the lower South cotton states. Washington and his men steered the Creole to Nassau in the Bahamas, where British authorities freed the slaves and refused to extradite the rebels. Around 60 boarded a ship to an anonymous freedom in Jamaica. The non-resistant garrison praised the, quote, hero mutineers of the Creole, especially their leader, Madison Washington, and published a call for a petition to place his portrait in the Library of Congress. That didn't go anywhere. The Creole Rebellion led anti-slavery congressmen to not only question the pro-slavery position of the US government, which kept asking the British to extradite the rebels or pay compensation to the slaveholders. So they led them to question this kind of stance, pro-slavery diplomatic stance of the US government, but also it led them to defend the slaves' right to rebel. You'll see that the anti-slavery Whig congressman, Joshua R. Giddings, presented his famous resolutions on the Creole case in Congress on March 21, 1842. Formulated by the abolitionist Theodore Weld, the Creole resolutions asserted that slavery being, quote, an abridgment of the natural rights of man could exist only in, quote, municipal law, meaning local law in the South. They further stated that the Creole rebels were not liable to the, quote, slave laws of Virginia and had not violated any law of the US in resuming their natural right to liberty. Horrified Southerners quickly moved to censure Giddings for his support of, quote, mutiny and murder. Giddings resigned his seat and was overwhelmingly re-elected from his abolitionist Western Reserve District in Ohio. Now, Giddings was one of the founders, of course, of the anti-slavery Republican Party in the 19th century. Of course, this is when the Republican Party was the party of Lincoln, not the party of Trump. So anti-slavery men evoked international law against Southern slavery. It is the duty of the free states, or remarks suggested by the case of the Creole, William E. Channing, pictured on your left, wrote that the federal government should not be obligated to defend slavery, quote, in its intercourse with foreign nations. Abolitionist William Jay in the middle, the son of the founding father John Jay, who was of course involved in the New York Manumission Society, argued that municipal laws that violated human rights like slavery were not recognized in international law or entitled to the Comity of Nations. Slave law ceased to exist in the high seas, and slaves had the right to resist their enslavement, quote, even unto death. In defending the slaves' right to rebel, abolitionist legal theory made human rights an essential attribute of domestic and international law. A higher law, as it was simplistically termed by their critics, than slave law. But this notion of refusing to obey unjust laws was something that abolitionists pioneered in long before the Nuremberg trials of the 20th century. We often forget that they were the first to make human rights an essential component of all law, of arguing that any law that is legitimate should recognize human rights. Abolitionist discourse increasingly centered around slave resistance. This was exemplified in their addresses to the slaves. In 1842, Gerrit Smith, pictured here on the right, the wealthy philanthropist, composed an address to the slaves of the United States of America on behalf of the New York Anti-Slavery Society. Smith encouraged slaves to run away and steal whatever provisions they may require to sustain themselves, and asked all abolitionists to promote the escape of slaves from their cold prison house. Garrison, often caricatured as a non-violent moralist, issued his abolitionist address to the slaves in 1843. The course of action that he recommended were not, quote, appeals, warnings, rebukes, arguments, and facts that abolitionists had deployed so far, but one inspired by the, quote, 20,000 of your number who have successfully run away, many of whom are now residing in the North, but a very large portion of whom are living in Canada. Black abolitionists went a step further. You will see that same year, in 1843, Reverend Henry Highland Garnett delineated a revolutionary plan for the overthrow of slavery in his address to the slaves delivered at the National Black Convention in Buffalo. These were black conventions mainly organized by black abolitionists, and they met every year nearly, except for a brief time in the late 1830s and early 1840s. They met every year, and they would continue to meet after the Civil War. And many black abolitionists from New Bedford actually attended these conventions and were elected to offices of these conventions. When Garnett published his address, along with Walker's famous appeal in 1848, he self-consciously situated it in a distinct black abolitionist tradition of protest. Unlike Smith and Garrison, he contended that slaves not run away from slavery to the North, and also called a slave revolt, quote, inexpedient, as it was doomed to failure, but recommended a general strike. As he said, quote, cease to labor for tyrants who will not remunerate you. His address, though, was understood as a call for slave rebellion with good reason. He surely knew that most of the most spectacular slave rebellions in Demerara and Jamaica had begun as strikes, as Frederick Douglass in his rebuttal contended. Garnett's advice to the slaves evoked rebellion, quote, let your motto be resistance, resistance, resistance. So long before the fugitive slave crisis of the 1850s, abolitionists justified the actions of slaves who stole themselves, fought back in self-defense, and slave rebels. Slave resistance not only revolutionized the abolitionist movement, but it also had a significant impact on national and the international politics of slavery. The political significance of slave resistance complemented the simultaneous emergence of anti-slavery politics in the North, and fugitive slaves became abolitionists' most effective emissaries. We will see that in the 1840s and 1850s, a new generation of fugitive slaves, including Douglass and, of course, Harriet Tubman, who will now raise our $20 bill, Henry Bibb, who published the newspaper Voice of the Fugitive from Canada, and others like Harriet Jacobs, who wrote her narrative, females among the first female slave narratives ever written. And in the middle, of course, is the case, the spectacular case of Henry Fox Brown, who shipped himself in a box to freedom. And he shipped himself to the Pennsylvania Anti-Slavery Society in Philadelphia. When they opened the box, they found him, and it was quite a story, because it was written in the box, he had written Fragile this side up, but they kept putting him on his head. And so he suffered a lot during this this journey, he just had a bladder of water to keep himself alive. He later on went on being very successful in the abolition lecture circuit, reenacting his escape, and miraculously sort of jumping out of the box, both in the North and in England, where he eventually lectured. And then, of course, James W.C. Pennington, who was one of the first fugitive slaves to become a prominent abolitionist. He named himself after the Quaker abolitionist who had helped him, attended theology classes in Yale, sitting separately because they wouldn't allow him to enroll, and became the first black man to receive an honorary doctorate from the University of Heidelberg in 1849. In 2011, the University of Heidelberg endowed a fellowship in Pennington's name, and since not many people know about him, they asked me to deliver the inaugural lecture for it, which I did, and President Obama sent his greetings, saying that Pennington reminded him a lot of himself. He had come out of nowhere, fugitive slave, self-drawn, becomes a prominent abolitionist, spokesman for the peace movement, and of course, becomes very active within the abolitionist movement. So these cases really do show us that fugitive slave abolitionists were in fact extremely effective in conveying the message of abolition, both here in the North and abroad, because they could speak from experience of the horrors of slavery, and they had the best rebuttals to slaveholders who were presenting a kind of benign, benevolent, moonlight and magnolia myth of plantation slavery. Now, the spectacular confrontations between fugitive slaves and their abolitionist allies and slaveholders who deployed the entire oppressive machinery of the state against them in the decade before the Civil War, we see some of these cases. The Christiana riot that took place in Pennsylvania, shown below. The Anthony Burns case, Anthony Burns is pictured there in the middle on top, where the president had to send in federal troops to Boston to enforce the fugitive slave law. The Joshua Glover case in Wisconsin, he's on the top right, he escaped to Canada, and his case, or the people who assisted him, their case went right up through the Wisconsin Supreme Court, which nullified the fugitive slave law of 1850. That was the new draconian law that was passed to prevent these escapes and abolitionist assistance to enslaved people. And then, of course, the most famous case of the Oberlin Wellington, which was also a hotbed of abolition in Ohio. They have the enslaved, a former slave, John Price, eluded his master and slave catchers. And many of these people who were involved, you see that good picture of them in the Oberlin Wellington case, some of them actually ended up joining John Brown. So these cases kind of built on the legal, political, and grassroots abolitionist activism that had been inspired by slave resistance even before the enactment of the Fugitive Slave Act of 1850. John Brown's raid on Harper's Ferry in 1859 there does not appear as the action of an aberrant or lone abolitionist. Brown, who began his abolitionist career by forming an all-black League of Gileadites in Springfield, Massachusetts, to resist the operation of this new draconian law, was that his actions were really a culmination of the radicalization of American abolition by slave resistance. His prominence in both the Kansas Wars and the fugitive slave rescues signaled a militant phase in the abolitionist war against slavery, but one that was inspired by the actions of the enslaved. Brown, an admirer of the Haitian Revolution and the Jamaican Maroons, conceived of his plan to start a slave rebellion and establish a revolutionary community of escaped slaves in conjunction with black and white abolitionists. On his execution, abolitionists, even those like Douglas, who did not accompany him, and Garrison, who eschewed his violent means, claimed him as one of their own. Radical Republicans like Chase, John Sumner, John Andrew, and Owen Lovejoy, the brother of the martyred abolitionist editor Elijah Lovejoy, refused to adhere to their party's moderating strategy for the 1860 presidential elections, and they too praised John Brown. So, our last slide here, I would argue then that the Civil War alliance between the enslaved abolitionists and radical anti-slavery politicians had been long in the making. The thousands of slaves who voted with their feet and fled to Union Army lines and donned its uniform to take up arms against their enslavers were a culmination of a long history of resisting slavery. We don't understand emancipation in the Civil War in this manner. We usually think of it as a decree coming down as a proclamation from the president. And indeed, the president was involved in emancipation. Clearly, he moved and he did indeed free slaves who were still in the Confederacy. But really, that process began with enslaved people right from the start of the war fleeing to Union Army lines. They were simply doing what generations of fugitive slaves had done, which was to seek out free spaces. And they, in fact, with the approach of the Union Army, did so. It is also important to remember that over 90% of black Union Army soldiers were former slaves. So they were literally taking up arms against their own masters. Slave rebels and fugitive slaves had helped set in motion the emancipation of the entire race. Thank you for listening so patiently.